Is there a danger in someone being both a writer and director? Same project?
There's a big one. I think, yes, there's both a danger and a huge danger and a huge advantage. And a lot of it depends on the personality. The huge advantage of a writer-director is potentially, possibly, and I say that possibly because it doesn't happen enough, is that as the writer, the director really understands the material very well and has a deep knowledge and experience and with these characters and with this story. So that's the possible huge advantage. The disadvantage or the danger is, getting back to, this is a big part of the weekend workshop we'll be doing, is that person, that writer director, has lost a collaborator. The director lost the writer and the writer lost the director. In other words, it's one person. So the collaborative process is, a part of the collaborative process is gone. And I work with a lot of writer directors. And one reason I work with them a lot, because I'm a director and also a writer, is they will bring me in as the collaborator. I'll have writers bring me a script that they're going to direct and said, okay, still working on the script. You be the director. I go, got it. In other words, they're wisely getting the collaborative process back, even though I'm not the director, but I'm approaching it from a director's point of view and critiquing it and looking at it and analyzing and breaking down and questioning them from a director's point of view. And then, because I continue working with them, then when they're directing, I'm there protecting the script. You know, in other words, so I have become that other person, although I'm not the director and I'm not the writer. So there's that collaborative process that is really, really important, and it's kind of sad. And the other thing, the negative is, I wrote it, I understand it, I'll know how to direct it. And that kind of arrogance can be really, really damaging because there's just, and then also I've run into producers say, well, he wrote it, he'll know how to direct it. You know, so people even outside of that one person believe, oh, they'll know. And it doesn't, there it's two such totally different disciplines, writing and directing. Don't assume because someone's written it that they will know how to direct it.
Are you coming? Oh, sorry.
Well, I was just going to say it's probably a safer bet that they won't. I mean, I think that even though there, when you look at the Oscars and so on, there are a number of writer-directors that reach that pinnacle and can do both, I think the likelihood is they won't do both jobs equally well, or they won't do both jobs superbly. You kind of alluded to this in your story about London, I think it was, where they were giving everybody a camera. Mm-hmm. But I think film school, for example, kids go to film school thinking, I want to make movies, I want to be a director, I've got to write my own, but all I really care about is getting behind the camera and doing that, mm-hmm. and they never really learn or don't even understand quite the value of, you got to know how to tell a story. Beyond knowing how to tell it visually, you got to understand a story and all those principles. I think when writers become successful writers and then move up to being directors, that might stand a greater likelihood in some cases of them doing both well, because they've proven the storytelling part. And then usually what they'll do is surround themselves with cinematographer and editors and people who know those craft part of it so well that they get a lot of support there. But finding somebody who, those are two hard jobs, finding somebody who does both superbly well at the same time, that's gotta be a tough order.
It's very rare.
Do both need a buffer from their own process?
What do you mean by buffer?
Well, someone to be objective and to stand, you know, you talked about when you are working with the director, then you're sort of protecting the script and then vice versa. So do they almost need some type of a buffer to do the same thing to protect?
Well, I think so. I think, you know, if that someone says I've written a script and I'm going to direct it, the more people they can involve that they trust, that have skills and knowledge of writing and directing, that they can engage in the process and their process and allow themselves to listen to these other people. Or even a writer, a director, let's say a director who's written a script and wants to direct it, and he's got the chance to direct it, but he's not really not that accomplished writer, but he's an accomplished director. Even to come to someone like Michael, say, okay, listen, I'm going to direct this thing and I've written it. I want to come to you as just the writer. Forget the directing part and look at it from a writing side. In other words, if they're willing to go to other people and say, help me here. I mean, I get this sometimes with someone who's written something and they come to me and they're going to direct it. And they said, help me, understand how to direct it. So if they can have that open, that courage, back to courage again, that courage to put themselves in front of somebody who really does know what they're doing. Even just go to another filmmaker that has really done well, that's successful, that's made some, as an accomplished filmmaker, and say, tell me what to do here. Tell me, and don't get trapped into the arrogance, like, I wrote it, there's the money, I'm going to direct it, I know what I'm doing. Everybody around you will support that idea. You must know what you're doing. Don't get seduced by that.
And lastly, what's the reality of people being willing to relinquish that control? Again, lip service, people thinking, oh, sure, not a problem, I'll bring in collaborators. But
What's the reality?
Slim.
Very, very slim. I mean, I've worked with some directors who have come to me. They're not writer directors, just come to me and they have a project. It's all financed. It's going to go. It's with someone like Miramax or something like that. And they come to me for support just on the directing side. And I'm amazed how many of them will fight me. No, I can't do it that way. I sometimes say, well, why are you here? In other words, what I'm running into is that resistance for something new. The resistance to hear a new way, and this is what Michael's been talking about today too. The resistance of, here's another possibility. Have you thought of doing it this way? Have you thought of staging it this way? Have you thought of approaching the character this way? And you can feel that resistance. They don't want to. So that courage and that ability to really listen and take to heart what you're seeing, be willing to dismiss it later if you think it's not telling the story you want to talk about. As Mike was saying earlier, say, no, that's not the story I want to tell. That's outside the realm. And I say, great, if you're clear on that, that's fine. But that resistance is, it's there a lot. It's sad.
It's the same thing with writers. I mean, it's, as a consultant, you're sort of saying the same thing. This doesn't happen a lot, but there are always the clients who come and you realize after working with them a while, what they really were paying that money for is so you could reinforce their belief that they're great, and they just want you to give a stamp of approval to what they've done so they can kind of move on and feel comfortable. And when you really get in and start challenging some of those things or going deeper with it, they're not really up for that. That isn't the norm. That's more rare. It's interesting here because I'm thinking about this and it feels like we sort of come full circle, because if there's one thing I bet we've said about 20 times in this whole interview, the same two words keep coming out, or same two ideas, and that is ask great questions and listen. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you have those two abilities and the courage to do that throughout, that's going to just elevate your talent as a writer, director, or whatever. Just keep asking good questions, then listen.
Yeah, many times on the listening side, I've said to clients, because I can feel that they're not really listening. I'm sure you get that thing where you go, and I say, are you listening? Yeah, I'm listening. I said, fine. But did you hear what I said? Yeah. And they go, huh? Did you hear? In other words, like the words went through them, but they kept going, And many times I said, okay, tell me what I just told you. Just repeat it back to me. And sometimes they can't. Because there's a part of them that just keeps deflecting. It goes through them and it gets deflected to somewhere else. But I think it's one of the toughest things for any artist, writers, directors, actors, any artist, to be able to sit down and listen to comments, critiques, analysis, ideas on their work. I wrote this, I'm directing this, on their work, on their concept. And you're right, they want to hear, this is going to be great. They want to hear, this is a wonderful script. They want those accolades, that affirmation, that validation. Quite honestly, that's not our job. I mean, I can look at something, a director's work, and say, you're really good, but I'm thinking, you could be better. My job is to make you better, which means we're going to get into a critique. My job is not to sit here and, you know, put gold stars on your forehead, because that who cares? You can do that by yourself. You came to me because you want to be better. But then there's a resistance. Yeah, but I don't want to hear the bad stuff. I don't want to hear. I don't even hear how I could be better, because that means more work, more study, more concentration. Which I think we both do. It means I, as an artist, have to move outside of my comfort zone, which is what story is all about. Right. Get outside the comfort zone. I'm going to go out there where it's uncomfortable, where it's challenging, where there are risks, where there are obstacles. Oh, I don't want to do that.